Hello students, good morning. We are going to start with again our second class for the current affairs, and this would be the 18th of December, so the news will be covered. Okay, and I will be covering the mainly the Hindu newspaper, also the Indian Express also, but preferably I will be using the Hindu newspaper. Okay, so you can also refer the Hindu newspaper. I hope you are reading the Hindu newspaper also daily. So you can read either the Hindu newspaper or Indian Express, anyone. Both are equally good, but I would suggest you to read the Hindu newspaper. All right. So let's begin with the today's current affairs news. Okay. So today's the biggest news is PSLV C50 CMS-01. Okay. So that is basically the India's communication satellite. Okay, as you have seen here, it is named as CMS-01. So it is communication satellite, right? So it is a communication satellite which was launched by the vehicle. That vehicle is named as PSLV C50. All right. So this is the vehicle through that the satellite have been launched. The satellite have been named as CMS-01. So it is basically a communication satellite that basically used for communication purpose. All right. And this satellite was basically launched from Satish Dhawan Space Center, that is also in the short form SHAR, which is located on Sriharikota Island, right? So this is basically communication satellite, which is named as CMS-01, which was launched on PSLV C50 launch vehicle from Satish Dhawan Space Center from Sriharikota. All right. So let's understand what is all about the communication satellite or CMS-01 preferably. All right. So CMS-01 is basically, you know, it's basically emphasized to provide all sort of services which are there in certain set of band, okay, or certain set of frequency spectrum. For example, this satellite or this communication satellite is mainly to extended C-band frequency spectrum, all right? So this is what is basically the spectrum allocation that we have discussed in our last class. So it is basically a band in which a certain amount of frequency or certain range of frequency would be used for the communication purpose, all right? And this satellite, this CMS communication satellite will be covering the mainly Indian mainland. Indian mainland means the Indian landmass. Apart from that, the Andaman and Nicobar Islands and Lakshadweep Islands, right? So you have, say the Bay of Bengal, you have your Lakshadweep Islands, and in the Arabian Sea, you have your Andaman and Nicobar Islands, right? So this satellite or this communication satellite will be covering the Indian mainland as well as Andaman and Nicobar Islands and Lakshadweep Islands, all right? And it is basically the India's 42nd communication satellite, okay? And this also has a predefined life, the life of seven years. So this would be used basically for your communication purpose, and that will have the lifespan of 7 years approximately. Okay. The satellite will be placed basically in a specified orbit. Okay. That orbit is defined here is called geosynchronous orbit. Okay. So this satellite will be placed in the geosynchronous orbit, and it will basically function as a continuation of GSAT-11, which was launched 11 years back. So you must understand, right? It will be used as a supplement, right? And it will be used as the continuation of the GSAT-11 satellite, which was also a communication satellite, and that was launched roughly around 11 years back. Okay. So it depends on the life of the satellite. For example, if this satellite also will be, say, after 7 years, may require to be replaced by another satellite. You're getting my point? So it depends on the life of the satellite, right? All right. And PSLV C50, as I told you, is a 52nd flight of PSLV. Okay, that is Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle. The full name of PSLV is Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle. And it is 22nd flight of PSLV in XL configuration with 6 strap-on motors, all right? So it is an improved version of the launched vehicle which was basically used to launch this communication satellite, which was named as CMS-01. So you can say that it is a 52nd flight of PSLV, and it is 22nd flight which was updated version of PSLV. All right. So this is just for your understanding. All right. So you can also see here, this is the satellite which was launched. Also, you can see here, it is whatever I have covered in the previous slide, it is written here. So it is a news clipping. You can see here, the CMS-01 is a 42nd communication satellite in the line, which was launched by the government of India, right? It will replace the GSAT-12 satellite, which was launched in 2011, all right. Okay. And as I told you, it is a communication satellite. So it will be basically providing certain telecom services, okay? The telecom services to the Indian mainland, apart from the Indian mainland, Andaman and Nicobar Islands and Lakshadweep Islands, right? And this will have the frequency spectrum in between the extended C band, right? So this band would be used for the communication purpose, right? Especially for the telecom services, all right? This, this extended C band that will have certain amount of frequency, right? That will be covering the Indian mainland as well as Andaman and Nicobar Islands and Lakshadweep Islands. As I told you, the mission for the life is around 7 years. All right. So this is what I have mentioned in my last class. You can see here. All right. Next news is India-Bangladesh virtual summit. Okay. So it was a virtual summit. You can say here, virtual summit means they are not physically present, right, in the close proximity, but rather they were present. Say Indian Prime Minister was present in India, and Bangladesh Prime Minister was present. Sheikh Hasina was present, say, in the Bangladesh. So it was a virtual meet. Okay, that's what the name is called, virtual meet. Okay, so here, because of the COVID situation or because of the COVID, the emergency, this meet was held. All right. So the Narendra Modi, who is the Indian Prime Minister of India, right, and the Sheikh Hasina, who is the Prime Minister of Bangladesh, held the virtual summit yesterday. That was happened on 17 December 2020. All right. What was the main the points that was discussed during that virtual summit that we have to discuss? Okay. So the two sides means here the India and the Bangladesh jointly inaugurated the Bang Bandhu Bapu Digital Exhibition. Okay. So this was basically jointly inaugurated by the India and the Bangladesh. All right. The two sides jointly inaugurated a railway link also. Okay. This railway link basically would connect the Haldiwadi in India and, Chilahati in basically Bangladesh. So Haldiwadi and Chilahati, that was two stations that will connect basically, or that will be connected through a railway link. Okay. This Haldiwadi and Chilahati route will be beneficial, right, for the Indian northeastern states also. For example, you have seen the India's figure or India's map. The Bangladesh is basically closely connected with in some of the few northeastern states, for example, Assam and West Bengal. Okay. If the Haldiwadi, which will be connected through the railway route to Bangladesh, obviously that will have the positive impact on the West Bengal as well as the Assam state. So that is why the Assam and West Bengal will be beneficiary while connecting this, these two stations or India and the Bangladesh through the railway route. Okay, different type of beneficiary. You can also assume that there will be, the trade will be enhanced. Okay, the economic, exchange will also be enhanced. The people can trade across the border very easily. Okay, the essential supply can also be transferred in the case of any sort of a, emergency. And also the most important, bilateral relations between the two countries will also be improved. So there will be lot of benefits which will be there, right, while connecting these two, the links or these two stations, that is Haldiwadi, which is in India, and Chilahati route, which is there basically in Bangladesh, All right. This was the main point. So the exhibition was inaugurated and the railway link was also inaugurated. So this is the most important glimpse of the virtual summit that was happened between India and the Bangladesh. The next is both sides also agreed to hold an early meeting of joint border conference. Okay. Because you must understand that there are a lot of issues also. So border management is also one of the important issue between India and the Bangladesh. So both sides basically agreed to hold an early meeting of the joint border conference to prepare a new set of strip maps. Okay, that maps will basically, you know, connect the Inchamati, Kalinidi, right, Ramongol and Haribanga rivers. Okay, so that will be connecting, or that will be basically stretching from these rivers. So that will basically also helpful in terms of the bilateral relationship, in terms of the mitigating any sort of a boundary dispute between the two countries. So this is what the main the glimpse of the India Bangladesh virtual summit that was happened yesterday. All right, the Bangladesh also requested India to name the historic road from the Mujib Nagar to Nodia on Bangladesh India border, okay, as a Shandi Noda Shorok road. You are getting my point. So why this Bangladesh was requesting that to connect this Mujib Nagar to Nodia on the India Bangladesh border as a basically, you know, Shandi Noda Shorok road? Because it was, you know, to commemorate the historic significance of road during Bangladesh Liberation War. So during 1971, when the Bangladesh was liberated, right, it was because of the India's great effort that has led to the liberation of the Bangladesh and emerging of the independent state that we call present time as Bangladesh. So to commemorate the historic significance, because that road was basically used, right, for the liberation of the Bangladesh, right? So that is what they want to rename that name of that road that basically connect India-Bangladesh border. All right. The following bilateral development partnership projects were also inaugurated. So apart from the exhibition and apart from the railway link that will connect between the two stations, right? The bilateral development projects was also inaugurated during this virtual summit. So that is beautification and the city development project in the Rajshahi city. Okay, so to improve the beautification, right, to improve the developmental projects of the Rajshahi city, it was also emphasized during virtual summit. And construction of Kalishpur Collegiate Girls School in Kulna, right? So this was basically also emphasized that this construction should also be moved ahead. All right, so these were basically, you know, some of the development project was basically inaugurated between the two countries. Then the next news was flashing basically the sessions of the parliament. As you know, the sessions of the parliament, so right now you have three sessions. All right, one is the summer session, another is basically your monsoon session, and the third one is basically your winter session. Okay, these are the three sessions. All right, now there is a break also in between that session, or there is a holiday in between the session. The houses never meet in between those sessions, that we call as a break of the session. All right, break of the session. So there the member of parliament do not meet in the houses, in the respective houses. So what is the news is government has said that the parties are in the favor of doing away with the winter session. All right, you are getting my point. So as I said, there are the three sessions: winter session, monsoon session and summer session. So government has said that the parties are in the favor to doing away the winter session. All right, so now that would be appropriate to have a budget session in the January. So instead of that winter session, they want the budget session to be starting from January onwards, right? So that is how the government is claiming. Now the power to convene the session, as you know, that rests with the government. All right, but you must understand the summon was sent, or the summon is sent by the President of India, but it is recommended by the Prime Minister of India or Government of India. All right, because the real executive powers lies with the Council of Ministers headed by Prime Minister of India. So this is how the parliamentary system in India works. As you know about polity in the right, and you would have covered your polity part also. So to convene the session, the summons was sent by, or the summons are generally sent by the President of India, but definitely they have been requested by the Government of India or Council of Ministers. All right, the decision is taken by the Cabinet Committee on the Parliamentary Affairs. So as we have also discussed, there are the Cabinet Committees Who are the cabinet committees? The cabinet committees are basically, are the devices or those committees which basically facilitate the in-depth examination of any particular issue. Or they basically also, reduce the workload of the cabinet. And they also propose, certain amount of the work. All right. So certain amount of work which will be there, and it also reduces the workload of your cabinet. All right. Which currently comprises the 9 ministers, including those for defense, home, finance, and the law. So you have seen here that it has been proposed, or the decision have been taken by the cabinet committee on the parliamentary affairs. Okay. All right. So this is what you must understand through this news. All right. Fine. Next. The next news, which is flashing here, the decision of the committee is formalized by the president, in whose name the MPs are summoned to meet for the session. All right. So that is what I said, is that the decision of the committee is formalized by the president, and in whose name the MPs are summoned to meet the session. Now, when this committee will take the decision, okay, cabinet committee on the parliamentary affairs will decide that we want to have any session, right? Any session means they want to assemble, or they want to summon all the MPs to be assembled together in the house. Ultimately, that will be taken in the name of the President of India. That will be taken in the name of the President of India, also by the President of India. All right. And the name or and the name, the MPs will be summoned to meet the session. This is how the process will be going on. The summoning of the parliament is specified in Article 85. All right, of the constitution, the provision specified that the central legislature has to be summoned to meet at least once a year. All right, and not more than 12 months could lapse between the two sessions. So that is Article 85. You would have heard about Article 85. So Article 85 says that the maximum gap between the two sessions shall not be more than 6 months. Or you can say that the central legislature here means parliament has to be summoned or has to be meet compulsorily at least once in a year. Or indirectly you can say that, or in the other way you can say that, there cannot be more than 6 months gap between the two sessions of the parliament, right? So that means you can say that not more than 12 months could be left between the two sessions. All right, so this is what Article 85 suggests. So legally you can say that the government can do that. So this is nothing like illegal of doing such things. But the point is that if the government is deliberately, skipping the session, or government is deliberately not conducting the session for saving itself from greater scrutiny from the opposition, or will have some certain amount of ill intention, that makes the whole process corrupt. And that is also, that also can be declared, unconstitutional by the judiciary. But the point is that just to skip the session for the necessity is nothing wrong in that, because Article 85 also says that there cannot be more than 6 months gap between the two sessions of the parliament. All right, this is what is you must understand. Then India does not have the fixed parliamentary calendar, so there is no such fixed parliamentary calendar as such. By convention, the parliament meets for 3 sessions in a year. All right, so that I have already told you, the 3 sessions are basically the budget session, monsoon session, and your basically winter session. All right, next. Currency manipulation. So next news is currency manipulation. So that time the United States of America, USA, or simply you say America, once again included India in its monitoring list of countries. Okay, so there is a list which basically made by the United States of America, which basically monitors those countries which has potentially questionable foreign exchange policies. Okay, so the point is that you have certain amount of convertibility issue. Convertibility issue means how much the foreign currency can be converted into the Indian currency, and how much the Indian currency can be converted into the foreign currency. If that is regulated by the central bank, central bank here is Reserve Bank of India. If that is regulated by the Reserve Bank of India, that means you cannot say that you have full account convertibility. Rather, you can say that we have no market mechanism per se. So the point is that if the government of India or the central bank is regulating or monitoring, right, this foreign exchange policies, and not, you know, it is market based, and that is how the United States of America also claim that it amount to currency manipulation. For example, if the foreign exchange reserve, or you can say that if the conversion ratio, right, let's say 60 rupees can purchase $1 or something like that, if that ratio have been manipulated, okay, according to the USA, that will have the impact on the trade, on the both the sides. So generally the countries use this manipulation to manage the trade deficit as well as to manage, right, some amount of the currency problem, some amount of, you know, the finance problem, finance related problems. All right, now the term currency manipulated that is there is label given by the US government to those countries, right? Now the India has also been included in that list, which are questioned as a currency manipulator because of the foreign exchange policies that India has right now. Okay, the US says that the India is engaging in unfair currency practices, okay, by unfair currency practices by deliberately devaluating their currency against the dollar. Okay, if we devaluate the currency against the dollar, what will happen? Obviously, there will be impact on the exchange, and there will be impact on import and export of the goods and the services. Okay, so that is what the US want, that should be there on the floating basis or on the market base rather than decided by the central bank. The practice would mean that the country in the question is artificially lowering the value of the currency to gain an unfair advantage over the others. That is what I was discussing, that if you artificially lower the value of the currency so that you can gain the advantage over the other currencies, right? Because you must understand, if you devalue your currency, for example, if I devalue the Indian rupees or Indian rupees currency, what will happen? That will reduce the cost of export. You are getting my point? That will reduce the cost of export, right, from that country, and show a reduction in the trade deficits as a result. Because if you reduce the cost of export, what will happen? Ultimately, you will save the money. If the cost of export will be reduced, you will save the money, and ultimately that money will be reflected in your trade accounts, or in your, basically, that account which basically shows the trade or export and import. And that will also, you know, have the impact on the reduction of the trade deficits. All right. So that is why the US also blamed on India, that India is a currency manipulator with artificially, exchange the policies which is related to the foreign exchange, and which has led to deliberately lowering the value of the Indian rupees or Indian currency, which has led to the undue favor which is, you know, goes to the Indian exporters in terms of the reduction of the cost of export, and this reduction would ultimately reflect in terms of the reduction of trade deficits, and which is led to, again, you know, imbalance between the trade between the two countries. And that is how certain manufacturing association in the USA also questioned this, the foreign policies or foreign exchange policies that India is implementing. All right. So this is what is the news. You must understand this news. All right. So let's move to the new news. Okay. For the brief, let's again understand this one, because this is the economy part. So you need to relate a lot of the things here. Okay. So the point is that for India, there will be pressure on the RBI, as I discussing about. So Reserve Bank of India is a central bank, which basically intervene during such time. Okay, so there will be pressure on the RBI to cut down intervention. The point is that why there will be a pressure on the RBI, you can say that because now US is pressurizing on India that don't intervene unnecessarily on the foreign exchange, right, foreign exchange policies. Now the regulation goes to the Reserve Bank of India because it is the only authority which has the authority to make the regulations. Now, ultimately, it will have the pressure on the Reserve Bank of India to cut down unnecessarily interventions, and so that intervention will ultimately lead to the appreciation of rupee. So rupee mein uchhal aa jayega, aur rupee mein uchhal aa jayega to export kya ho jayenge aapke, costly ho jayenge. Samajh mein aa raha hai na aapki baat ko? So the point is that now the rupee has not been appreciated. Rupee mein uchhal nahi aaya hai. Rupee mein kya gaya? Giravat aayi hai. Ye aap newspaper mein padha hoga, rupee mein giravat. तो उसका सबसे बड़ा रिजल्ट पड़ता है आपके एक्सपोर्ट्स का एक्सपेंडिचर होता है वो कम हो जाता है और आपका जो ट्रेड डेफिसिट है उसमें भी रिडक्शन होता है. समझ में आ रही ना आपके? तो एक्सपोर्ट माइनस इंपोर्ट, दैट इज हाउ योर ट्रेड बेसिकली यू नो योर ट्रेड बैलेंस विल बी शोन. सो दैट विल हैव द इंपैक्ट ऑन द एप्रिसिएशन ऑफ द रुपी. नेक्स्ट, व्हेन यू से इन टर्म्स ऑफ द रेस्ट्रिक्शंस, द टैग डज नॉट इन्वॉल्व एनी काइंड ऑफ ट्रेड रेस्ट्रिक्शंस. ओके, सो द पॉइंट इज दैट दिस टाइप ऑफ टैग, tag means the currency manipulator tag. So because you might have heard about that US also put the sanctions on the different countries. Okay, now if the US has tagged India as a currency manipulator, but this does not involve any sort of a sanctions on India's trade, that means export and import, does not have any involvement of such sanctions, that means there will not be any sort of impact on the trade, on any sort of a restrictions on the trade. So that will have, you know, no negative impact per se, but definitely that will pressurize the government of India and the RBI to not manipulate in the foreign exchange regulations. Okay, then what will be the impact on the economy? The impact on the economy, you can say that the rupee would partially offset the impact of rising oil prices on the import. Okay, so what will happen is offsetting means you are basically deliberately doing something so that you can make use of something, right? So that will basically, the rupee will offset the impact of rising oil prices, because the rupee will ultimately, what will happen, rupee will appreciate. So rupee will appreciate, your export, your cost of export will increase, your rising oil price, that will be offset by this whole process. What will be the impact for RBI? The central bank can increase the diversification of its reserve to include non-dollar assets. Okay, now why the central bank can increase the diversification of its reserve? Because you must understand, now there are different currencies like dollar, right, pounds, sterling, right? Isn't it, yuan, like different dollars are there. Now the mainly the trade happens in terms of dollar. Now if the central bank want to diversify its reserve to include non-dollar assets, that means can be gold or can be F, anything, can be of anything other than your dollar. Okay, so that will have, the RBI can diversify its trade basket or the currency basket or the reserve basket other than the dollar. So this is how you must understand through this page, that in the mains examination, the question will be, what will be the impact on Indian economy? What will the impact or for RBI, for India in terms of restrictions? So you need to understand this concept holistically, then only you will be able to answer this type of questions. Otherwise, it will be very, very difficult for you to answer this question, All right. Next, Ustad Iqbal Ahmed Khan. Okay. He was basically a music maestro. He was basically a music maestro. So you must understand this Ustad Iqbal Ahmed Khan was passed away at the age of 66. He was the music maestro. This was the news which was flashing in the Hindu newspaper. So let's begin a brief history about this Ustad Iqbal Ahmed Khan. Okay, he was born in 1954. Okay, and he was basically raised in the Delhi Gharana of music. If you study the art and culture, there are different gharanas. Okay, there are the different gharanas. One of the gharana is Delhi gharana. Okay, it is basically, you know, some lineages associated with that particular particular maestro is associated with that gharana. So people are known from belongingness of that particular gharana, if you read the art and culture book. All right, so he was basically raised or belonged to Delhi gharana of music. Okay, and he began his stage career, okay, under the guidance of his teacher and the grandfather, that was Ustad Chand Khan. Okay, so he started his career right under the guidance of his father itself, whose name was Ustad Chand Khan. And now he was closely following the family traditions. So that is why the Khan or Ustad Iqbal Ahmed Khan was actively promoted the Amir Khusro's music works. Okay. Now he was also founded. He also founded the Delhi Darbar. Okay, the Delhi Darbar aimed at renaissance of Indian classical music. Okay, to renaissance the Indian classical music, he founded this Delhi Darbar, and which held his first classical event in 2019 itself. Okay, so that is how his contribution with respect to the Indian music. So you can say that he founded the Delhi Darbar for the purpose of renaissance of Indian classical music. So its contribution in terms of the classical music is immense. And he with his help, the first classical event was held in Delhi, right, in 2019 itself. And he belongs to the Delhi Gharana of music, right? And he was basically a music maestro. All right, so this was the news which is flashing in our newspaper, in our today's newspaper. All right, we shall move to the new news. Okay, next is GPS-based toll collection system. Let's understand this GPS-based toll collection system. Everybody knows about the toll collection system. It's very simple. The toll collection system is a process through which you pay certain amount and you can pass through that particular toll. Okay, if you are there in the vehicle. Okay, for example, 200 rupees will be paid by you and your vehicle will be allowed to pass. Now this vehicles which was there has certain chip also, that is RFID system. Okay, radio frequency identification system, that is called RFID. So this radio frequency identification system which was sticked on the board or the windshield of the car is generally used for passes of these, this toll collection systems. Now, this is how the background is. Now, the Union Minister of Road Transport and the Highways has said that the government has finalized the GPS-based global positioning system. GPS is global position system technology of toll collection to ensure the seamless movement of vehicles across the country. Okay. Now, how would you say that the GPS technology can be used for collecting the toll? Okay, that is how a new technology which is coming to the India. Now the point is that because there is a lot of delays, you have seen the toll plazas, the trucks, the commercial trucks, they spend lot of times, even hours together, to pass through the toll collections, to pass through that any particular amount of toll. And that they spend a significant amount of time, and that has led to the significant amount of loss in terms of the man hours, in terms of the fuel, in terms of the cost which involve in transporting that particular product. So which basically negatively impact the customers. Ultimately, who will be sufferer? The common people will be sufferer, and ultimately the product will be more costly. So to remove that all problems, the Union Minister of Road Transport and Highways has decided that a GPS based, a new technology for toll collection will be there. Now India will ensure, or this will ensure, that India becomes toll booth free in next 2 years. Okay, so the point is that you need the toll for collecting the tolls, toll plazas. Now if you have GPS connected with you, let's say if you're traveling from one place to another place, would you still require the toll plazas? No, you won't require the toll plazas, because your vehicle is already connected with the GPS, and they can easily subtract that amount basically from GPS system. All right, there is no need to read anything. There is a RFID chip, that is radio frequency identification system, that is basically your, on the windshield generally you will have the RFID system. Okay, the toll amount will be deducted directly from the bank account based on the movement of the vehicle. That is what I was saying, that the toll amount will be automatically deducted because it's already connected with the GPS, and GPS will guide the server, right, where the vehicle is moving, and if the vehicle is crossing the particular destination or particular point, that will automatically deduct the amount from your bank account. From a bank account, you don't have to pay anything, or you don't have to have any sort of a wallet like RFID system. Okay, now all commercial vehicles are coming with the vehicle tracking system, the government will come up some plan to install GPS technology in the old vehicles also. Okay, now you must understand that now the few vehicles are coming with the tracking system or the GPS system, but the old vehicles does not have that system. So the government has decided to also install this GPS technology in the old vehicle. That can also be done. Okay, the minister expressed the hope that the toll collections may reach 34,000 crores by March 2021. Okay, by using GPS technology for toll collection, the toll income in next 5 years will be 1.34 lakh crore rupees. Why the road minister is so much optimistic about this much jump from 34,000 crore to 1.34 lakh crore? You can understand in the next 5 years, how can he so confident about it? Because the point is that there are a lot of irregulations also on the toll plazas. Okay, lot of misregulations. Many vehicles are allowed to pass without even toll, right? So there are other embezzlement of the money, corruption related issues, leakages are there in the system. Now this all leakages will be lost, and ultimately the government will be beneficiary, and this toll, the collected amount of toll will definitely be increased to, you say here, 34,000 crore rupees to 1.34 lakh crore rupees, almost four to five times it will increase in the next 5 years. All right, now next is World Anti-Doping Agency, WADA. That is World Anti-Doping Agency. So this is basically in the news. So what was the news? Let's first understand the news, then we'll understand this WADA. So India has pledged a sum of US $1 million, okay, all right, to World Anti-Doping Agency, right, for the different purpose. For example, the India has decided that it will basically finance the global agency's the scientific research budget. Scientific research budget means it is it will be used for develop an innovative anti-doping testing and detective methods. Because you must understand, this is the anti-doping agency which is involved in fighting against the drugs in the sports, because many sports person are caught, right, while taking the drugs and playing still in the games, right? So to develop an innovating anti-doping testing, right, testing process, testing kits, detection methods. So for that, India has basically pledged a sum of US $1 million to that WADA. Now this is the news which is flashing. Now let's understand briefly about the WADA. So World Anti-Doping Agency is a foundation initiated by the International Olympic Committee to promote, coordinate, and monitor the fight against drugs in the sports. Okay. Now, this, as I told you, this is a foundation which was initiated by the International Olympic Committee, right? Ultimate aim was to fight against the drugs in the sports, okay? Ultimately, to promote, to coordinate, and to monitor such drug abuse in the sports. All right. The agency means WADA's key activities are basically monitoring the World Anti-Doping Code. So that anti-doping code have been formulated by the WADA. So whether this anti-doping code have been strictly followed by different agencies, right, by the government or not. So to monitor them, right, whose provisions are enforced by the UNESCO's International Conventions Against the Doping in the Sport. All right. So that World Anti-Doping Code will be there will be certain amount of regulations, and that is enforced by UNESCO's International Convention Against the Doping in the Sports. Now, the headquarters for WADA, that is World Anti-Doping Agency, is basically in the Canada. Exact is Montreal in the Quebec, right? So it is located in Canada and it is established in 1999. It is established in 1999. All right. So this is about the World Anti-Doping Agency. All right. Next, the defense acquisition. The defense acquisition. So you must understand the different amount of, you know, the products have been, a different amount of, you know, the defense equipment have been, you know, in the process of acquisition by the defense ministry or by the government of India. So this defense acquisition council, who has the mandate to acquisition such, you know, the defense related equipment, in its meeting held that, you know, the chairman is basically chair, is basically chairing that meeting, which basically approved the proposal to procure an equipment worth of 28,000 crore rupees. Right. So this defense acquisition council, which is basically chaired by the defense minister Rajnath Singh, has decided to procure an defense equipment of worth rupees of 28,000 crore rupees. Now, this is the first meeting of the defense acquisition council under the new design of defense acquisition procedure 2020. So the new procedure was started by the government of India to acquisition of the defense related equipments, and this would be the, this was its first such meeting. And you must understand, there was certain set of the acceptance of necessity which was accorded to majority of the items, which was having certain categorization. For example, the highest categorization is the highest categorization of buy Indian products. Okay, so you must understand, this categorization has led to the development of the Indian manufacturing industries in terms of the defense also. So that basically has led to also boost in India's manufacturing industries also. 6 out of 7 proposals, that is, 27,000 crore rupees out of 28,000 crore rupees, of which the acceptance of necessity was granted, and that will be sourced from Indian industry. Okay, that is what I was saying, that when you categorize them, that you need to buy from Indian manufacturer. Okay, now you have been compulsion to buy from Indian manufacturer. Obviously, the 27,000 crore rupees out of 28,000 crore rupees will be allotted to be sourced from the Indian industry, and that will definitely boost the Make in India campaign. The Make in India campaign means you manufacture certain amount of the products in India itself, and that will also help in establishing of Atmanirbhar Bharat or Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative of Government of India. Okay, now this acquisition proposals approved today, which include the DRDO design development airborne early warning and control system. Okay, so that is basically to check any sort of a air warning or any sort of a, the airborne missiles or airborne rockets which may come into the Indian mainland. The next generation offshore patrol vehicles for Indian Navy. Okay, there are patrol vehicles which basically patrol all along the shore areas, right? So these patrol vehicles also will be procured from Indian manufacturer units, and also the modular bridges for Indian Army. Okay, that will be basically, enhance the operational capacity of Indian Army in that perspective. All right, let's begin to the new news. That is Yogasan. Okay, what is that Yogasan? So Ministry of Ayush and Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports announced, you must understand, the formal recognition of Yogasana as a competitive sports, right, at a joint press conference. Okay, so what will be the benefit of announcing the Yogasana as a competitive sport? So that we have to see. So now the Ministry of Ayush and Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports had announced that Yogasana will be called as, or will be known as, the competitive sport. Okay, this Yogasana, which is there now, announcing this Yogasana in the competitions, now it will be traced in the Indian yoga traditions, such as which was basically, held for the centuries together. Okay, and which has our deeply connected roots. So so by this, the Ministry of Ayush has claimed that this Yogasana has deeply ingrained into the Indian culture. And by declaring this as a competitive sport, that will also give moves to this, you know, the yogasana, this yogasana is an integral and important component of yoga, all right, which is a psychophysical in the nature and which is popular across the globe for its efficiency in the fitness and the general well-being. All right. So you must understand this yogasana will be useful for the fitness and the general well-being of the individual. And it is also very familiar throughout the world, throughout the globe. And it is basically psychophysical in the nature, which will ensure the well-being and the fitness of the people. Now, the competition that will be arising out of recognition of this yogasana as a sport will enhance the interest in the yoga. Because the point is that the yogasana can be traced to the yoga tradition. Okay. Now, once you declare the yogasana as a competitive sport, now what will happen? By declaring this as a competitive sport, that will automatically enhance the interest in the yoga, because it is ultimately the yoga tradition. Right. So when the people throughout the globe will be interested in the yoga, ultimately in the yogasana, that will also give boost to the yoga. Ultimately give boost to the yoga. And the government of India is planning to include yogasana as a sport discipline in the national games and Khelo India and international sports event. Okay. So also it will give boost to this new game. Also to this boost to the new game, which is related to the fitness and the general well-being of an individual, and it will be promoted in the national games, Khelo India, and international sports events also, so that it can be promoted to the countries in the world also. Then next is Rajachari. Next news is Rajachari. So Rajachari is among the three astronauts. Okay, so he is basically among the three astronauts, which was ultimately selected by the NASA. NASA, you know, the National Aeronautics Space Administration. Okay, so this Rajachari, which was selected, right, by the NASA and European Space Agency to fly to the International Space Station as a part of a SpaceX Crew 3 mission. Okay, so he was selected by NASA as well as the European Space Agency to be sent to the International Space Center or International Space Station, right, through this SpaceX vehicle or SpaceX Crew 3 mission. So these three astronauts will be sent to the International Space Station. All right. Now, this Indian American, which is named as a Rajachari, will be command the mission. So he will basically command the mission, and which is expected to launch in the fall of 2021. All right. So he will be part of the SpaceX Crew 3 mission. This SpaceX Crew 3 mission will be sent to the International Space Station. And he was basically selected by NASA and European Space Agency. Now, earlier this year in the January, the Chari became the one of the 11 astronauts to join the NASA's rank. Ultimately, that astronaut will be sent to the International Space Center. All right. The new graduates completed more than 2 years of basic training and become the first to graduate from NASA's Artemis program. Okay, so he was graduated from NASA's Artemis program and will be sent the next man and the first woman to the moon by 2022. All right, so you must understand he was also, have the Indian origin, but he is definitely residing currently in USA. All right, so this is the news we have covered in the today's newspaper. So you can also check it out once again. What are the important news we have covered in the today's news? The first news was the Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle C-50 has launched the communication satellite that was named as CMS-01. It was the 42nd satellite or 42nd communication satellite, and it is 52nd flight of PSLV and 22nd flight of advanced level of PSLV, which has configured as a XL level. All right. Now, the second is India-Bangladesh Virtual Summit. This was held between the Sheikh Hasina, the Prime Minister of Bangladesh, and Narendra Modi, the Prime Minister of India. And the main glimpse is basically the two sides inaugurated the Bang Bandhu Bapu Digital Exhibition. The second is they inaugurated the railway link between the Haldibari in India as well as the Chilchilahati in Bangladesh. And they both side also decided to have some joint boundary conference, and which will be connecting the rivers across the boundary. And the Bangladesh has requested the India to rename the road, right, which is there in the border area of Bangladesh and India, as a commemorating of the historic significance of liberation of the Bangladesh that connect basically the Mujib Nagar to basically Nodia, right, in the Bangladesh-India border. And ultimately, they have also inaugurated the development project in the Rajshahi city and the Khulna. All right. The sessions of the parliament, the government has decided, or government has said that the parties was the favor to skip the winter session. All right. To skip the winter session. All right. This was their currency manipulation. As I told you, the US has put the India basically in the monitoring list of currency manipulator because of questionable foreign exchange. And I have discussed already the various implications of putting the India into currency manipulator. Okay. Then Ustad Iqbal Ahmed Khan, who was basically the music maestro, has recently passed away. Yesterday, he was 66 years old. And he was basically belongs to the Delhi Gharana of music. And he also set up the Delhi Darbar for renaissance of Indian classical music. And the Union Minister of Road Transport and Highways has proposed the GPS-based toll collection system that will basically enhance the connectivity between the stations, and that will basically also lead to the economies of the scales, right, in that perspective. India has pledged a sum of rupees of $1 million for the anti-doping agency's innovative anti-doping testing and detection methods, or to do certain amount of scientific research budget. All right. Then Defense Acquisition Council, I told you that around 28,000 crore rupees have been approved for the proposal to procure certain defense related equipments. And out of 28,000 crore rupees, 27,000 crore rupees defense-related equipment will be procured from Indian manufacturers, and that will boost the Indian manufacturer sector also in the defense field. Then yogasana have been declared as a competitive sport. What will the benefit of declaring the yogasana as a competitive sport? It will basically promote the yoga, because yogasana ultimately can be traced to the yoga tradition, and that will basically have certain amount of fitness and general well-being. And by declaring this yogasana as a sport, that will enhance the interest in the yoga. And government of India has already planned to promote this yogasana as a sport in the national games, Khelo India, and international sports events. All right. And Rajachari, who is the Indian origin, who was basically selected by the NASA and European Space Agency, right, to fly to the International Space Station as a part of SpaceX Kutri mission. All right. So these are the few important news that was flashed. All right. So we'll meet again tomorrow. Thank you very much for attending this session. Thank you.